Biology. Today I will be covering reproduction in organisms. Before, I will briefly run through how to access revision notes and test in clay6.com. Open the clay6.com page, click on practice. You will get a lot of packages. Since we are doing NEET classes, let me click on NEET Premium. And here you will find lot of tests in physics, chemistry and biology and NEET full test. Since we are starting with class 12 portions, let me click on class 12. So reproduction, here you find a lot of tests which are in different colored bubbles. Each bubble is a test. Now the green bubble shows that the test has been completed. And you can take the test any number of times if you want, either for revision or to improve your score after learning the concepts thoroughly. Blue bubble indicates that you are yet to take the test. And here there are no yellow bubbles for you to show. If anything is incomplete, it will show in the yellow color. Sometimes we would have started the test and we would not have completed it because we would realize after three or four questions that we are not adequately prepared for the test. And so you might want to leave the test, or due to poor connectivity, you are not able to go through the test, whatever is the reason. If you have discontinued the test, it will be shown in an yellow bubble. And this is a red bubble. It's a randomized test. If you look at chapters, depending upon the complexity of the text and its importance and need, we have created the tests here. So these tests, when you have completed all the tests, maybe you can take the red bubbled or the randomized test, wherein answers, questions will be popping in from all the tests which you have already solved. This would help you to really understand and analyze yourselves about your understanding and application of the concepts. Now, if you click on this revision notes, it will lead to a PDF. Now, I hope you have got to know how to navigate to the website. In today's class, I will be revising the key concepts, do a practice test based on concepts learned, and last 5 minutes, I will answer your queries. Now, if you look at it, I'm sure you're all eagerly waiting for your NEET exams, and also it's a kind of a mixed bag feeling. Some who are really prepared are eagerly waiting. For some, that fear will always be there. But relax, at least in biology, I would say that when we have analyzed it, we have found that there are three kinds of questions. Around 68 to 70 questions are from NCERT textbook. If you have learned NCERT thoroughly, you will be able to score complete marks. The next set of questions, 8 to 10 questions, would be featuring from past papers. These questions we have seen many times, either with very little modification or no modification is seen in the test. So if you are prepared with that, that will also help you a lot. And only 8 to 10 questions are quite new for a NEET test in biology. So these become the game changer. If you really want to score marks in this, you should prepare for these game changer questions. Mere mugging of the concepts will not really help you. You need to understand the concept and also know how to apply the concept. So keeping in view all these things, in Clay 6, we have prepared the tests in such a way that it would really help you and gear you up to face all the three kinds of questions. I hope now you have got the framework. Let us begin the lesson. So I would still suggest that having this package as a study tool will really help you. Now let us look into today's lesson, reproduction in organisms. So, you know, this is the PDF. Whatever you have learned in 11th and 12th has been summarized to 135 pages using a lot of graphic organizers and key concepts so that you can revise things within a few minutes or within an hour. You will be able to complete the revision if you are giving up your exams. And this will also help you to analyze whether a particular concept you have understood or not, or whether you should relearn it. So that, again, I would suggest it would be an asset for your preparation. Now let us get back to reproduction in organisms. You know, reproduction is a process by which an organism produces young individuals of its own life. It thus maintains the continuity of the species. Now, lifespan is the period spanning from birth to the natural death of an organism. Now, there are two kinds of reproduction. One is asexual reproduction, the other is sexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction, you know, it's a method of reproduction in which Genetically identical offsprings are produced from a single parent. Now let us look at the what is asexual reproduction. Basically, what are the characteristics? It is uniparental. There is no involvement of a male and a female parent. It is only one parent. Unit of reproduction, which is also called as propagule, is an unspecialized or a specialized part of the parent. Propagules are commonly formed from the somatic cells of the parents. Since they are from the somatic cells, they will obviously be diploid in nature. There is no fusion of gametes, and hence it is also called agamogony or agametogenesis. Meiosis is generally absent. As it is dealing with the somatic cells, most of the divisions will be mitotic. The young ones will be morphologically and genetically similar to the parents, and hence they are called clones. There is no haploid or diploid differentiation in the body. It is an easy and quick way to multiply. So these are the characteristics. Now, what are the advantages? So the characteristics also provide advantage, but let us look at the disadvantages of asexual reproduction. It leads to overpopulation and overcrowding, as a result of which what happens, there will be a lot of competition and no new variations are seen. You know, variations are possible only by meiotic divisions, wherein there will be exchange of the genetic material. But since there is no involvement of meiotic division, and since only it is mitosis, there is no new variations that are seen. Since no crossing over also takes place, there will be no formation of new linkages. You know, variations are the tools for evolution, and when there are no variations, these asexual reproduction does not really play a very big role in evolution. Now, if you look at the organism's ability to changes in the environment is low due to the absence of new variation. So this is about the structures of the disadvantages of the asexual reproduction. And now if you look at what are the different structures, you can think of amoeba, paramecium, euglena, multicellular metazoans like cycon, hydra, turbularia, planaria, acidia. They all show asexual reproduction. So asexual reproduction can be three common modes. One would be fission, budding, and fragmentation. I mean, the fission can be simple binary fission, or it could be multiple fission. Budding is commonly seen in the hydra. Now let us look at vegetative reproduction. Actually, in animals and other simple organisms, we use the term asexual, but the term vegetative propagation or vegetative reproduction is used for the plants. So it is a reproductive process that is asexual, and so does not involve recombination of genetic material. It involves unspecialized plant parts, which may become reproductive structures like roots, stem, or leaves. The methods of vegetative propagation are grouped into natural and artificial. You should understand vegetative propagation takes place by stems, roots, leaves, and from reproductive organs. Artificial methods would be like your cuttings, layering, grafting, gooty, and all these things. And vegetative propagules would include rhizome, tuber, bulb, runner, sucker, and offset. Now let us look into this slide. Is very important. Please make a note, because they would ask you what is the vegetative propagule in the plant, or what is the kind of modification you see. Stems, tubers, artichoke, potato, bulbs, garlic and onion, corms, colocasia and amorphophallus, suckers, chrysanthemums and mint, rhizomes, ginger and turmeric, runners, oxalis and centella, stolons, wild strawberry and jasmine, offset, pistia and icornia, bulbils, bryophyllum, turions, poto, megaton and atricularia. Now with this we complete with asexual reproduction and vegetative propagation. Now what are the advantages of vegetative propagation? So you might wonder, what is the need? So the need is, some plants multiply only through vegetative propagation because they do not produce the seeds. If you see in banana, sugarcane and pineapple. Now, plants which have got reduced power of sexual reproduction can be multiplied very easily by vegetative propagation. Example, Cynodon, Dactylon. And plants with long seed dormancy or poor seed viability are easily multiplied through this method. If your area is denuded, there is no vegetation. If you quickly want to build up the vegetation, the easiest way would be through vegetative propagation. It overcomes the difficulty in establishment of the plants in the new areas where propagation through seeds often fail. So, and hence it is a quicker method of multiplication. So these are the advantages of vegetative propagation. Still, there are lots of advantages because you see most of the plants going in for vegetative propagation. Survival rate is 100% when compared to less than 1% through the seeds. You can preserve good qualities of a race, variety and species indefinitely because whatever the organism you are going to get will be a clone. Superior variety with poor root system can be propagated through cuttings. Now, grafting helps in combining good traits of two or more varieties into a single composite plant. That is why you will get mangoes, many different varieties of mangoes, because most of the varieties are developed through grafting. It reduces the period required for flowering and fruiting of the plants. Certain common infections can be rectified through pruning and micrografting. Now, the yield is of uniform quality as you do not see variations, and these variations do not develop in the absence of gene combinations. So these are the advantages. Now let us look at the advantages. So as we saw, the plus points are so many. There are also negativity crowd with this. That means to say that since dispersal is nearly absent, dispersal, you know, taking in the propagules from one place to a distant place, that is not possible. What happens wherever it is getting vegetatively propagated, overcrowding takes place. And when there is overcrowding, there will be a lot of competition for the nutrients and space among the organisms. Vegetative propagules, you can't store them for a long time because they are prone to infections, drying up and decay as they are not protected. Like seeds, you might have seen seeds are dry structures which when you put it in water and soil, then they germinate and start growing. You can preserve the seeds for any number of days. It will be viable once when it comes in contact with the soil and water, or even it can be under a dormant condition for a very long time. But vegetative propagules, you do not see them like that. You have seen variability is absent. Because variability is absent, even adaptability will also be very less or very low. Now, what happens is when you're repeatedly subjecting a particular plant only for vegetative propagation, then there will be a degeneration in its genetic quality over a period of time when the external environment keeps changing. So there is no mechanism for you to introduce good traits or eliminate the bad traits. If a disease is present in the parent plant, it spreads in all the directions. So we need to look into all these pros and cons and then decide whether a plant has to be subjected to vegetative propagation or should it go for sexual reproduction. Now, we have seen a list about what are the disadvantages of sexual reproduction. Now, let us look into sexual reproduction. What are the characteristics? You know, parents, there are two parents, parent, male parent. Particular set of organs. Females will have female sex organs, and they will undergo meiosis during the production of the gametes. Gametes that are formed will be subjected to fertilization. Upon fertilization, they will become a zygote. Now, these are the features of the sexual reproduction. Now, it is a very slow process. It does not take place as quickly as vegetative propagation. And here you will find a distinction between haploid phase and a diploid phase. So wherever there is a formation of gamete, it is in a haploid phase. Fertilization will result in zygote, which is a diploid. So you have already studied about sporophyte and gametophyte in the lower forms. So this is what happens during sexual reproduction. So what are the phases in the sexual reproduction? So juvenile phase, reproductive phase, and senescence phase. Now let us look into the age phase. What is meant by a juvenile phase? A juvenile phase is a period gone through by some plants, especially woody perennials, during which the plant cannot reproduce reproductive structures even if all appropriate environmental conditions are present. So juvenile phase I gave here for a plant. But these all the three phases holds good both for animals and also for the plants. In the juvenile phase, you will see an organism getting ready for the next phase, that is the reproductive phase. So in the reproductive phase, the actual reproduction takes place, gametes will be produced, and in this phase, the organisms will be ready for undergoing reproduction. So in the plants, you find reproduction by the way of flowers become the reproductive structures. In animals, it is due to copulation through which reproduction occurs. And the last is the senescence phase, the growth phase in a plant or in an animal, which after the growth phase, the phase where the reproductive phase ends, we call it as the senescence phase, where it starts decreasing, all the metabolic activities, hormones all keep decreasing in the body, and this stage is called as the senescence stage. Now you should also know about two other things. One is the estrous cycle and another is the menstrual cycle. Estrous cycle refers to recurring physiological changes that are induced by the reproductive hormones in most mammals like cow, sheep, rat, deer, dogs, tiger, etc. It is the period of time when the female is receptive to the male and will stand for mating. Now, if you look at mammals, they do not exhibit, phase, estrous cycle will be operational only in a particular period of time. But if you look at other organisms like mammals, they have a reproductive phase continuously, and they are called as continuous breeders. Example, humans, wherein you will see the menstrual cycle, the details of which I will be talking in the third lesson. Now, this is about the phases in the life cycle. Now, what are the events in the sexual reproduction? So, the first phase is the pre-fertilization event, that is before fertilization. You know, fertilization means union of male and female gametes to produce a zygote. Now, before fertilization, what should happen? They should happen through gametogenesis. Gametogenesis means formation of gametes. So, it has to be the formation of sperms or gametes, that can be spermatogenesis or it could be oogenesis. Now, it can also lead to homogametes, means that are similar in size, and they are also called isogametes. Gametes produced can be either heterogametes or they can be physiologically different gametes, like an antherozooid or sperm and egg or ovum. Homothallic means having both male and female reproductive structures on the same thallus. Heterothallic means having male and female reproductive organs on different thalli. Monoecious refers to those flowering plants in which male and female organs, that is reproductive organs, are found on the same plant, as in maize, etc. Hibiscus. Dioecious refers to those flowering plants in which male and female flowers are found on different plants. Example, cucurbits and coconuts. Now, this is about gametogenesis. Now, the next thing is gamete transfer. So, how does the gamete get transferred? If you look at bryophytes, pteridophytes and all, it is through the watery medium. They require the gamete transfer. Water, they are by archegonium. If the pollen will come and land on the stigma, and then there is a transfer of the gamete. Actually, this is about the gamete transfer, but if you look in animals, it could be either by external fertilization or internal fertilization through copulation. Now, let us look at fertilization. In the term, syngamy means fusion of gametes, and it describes the event that two sexes come close to each other and fuse. The term fertilization encompasses all the associated events that ultimately lead to syngamy. In most aquatic fishes as well as amphibians, syngamy is the external medium, that is outside the body of the organism. This type of gametic fusion is called to fungi, higher plants, reptiles, birds, mammals, and in majority of the plants, syngamy occurs outside the body of the organism. Inside the body of the female organism, and hence it is called as internal fertilization. Now, after fertilization, let us look into post-fertilization events. So, there are two events. One is formation of zygote and then embryogenesis. Now, you know that zygote is the diploid cell produced by the fusion of the nuclei of the male and the female gamete after fertilization. Embryo is the name given for the early developmental stage of an animal or a plant following fertilization of an ovum. In humans, the term embryo describes the fertilized egg during its first 7 weeks of existence. From the 8th week onwards, it will be called the fetus. Now, embryogenesis refers to the process of development of embryo from the zygote. During embryogenesis, zygote undergoes cell division and cell differentiation. While cell divisions increase the number of cells in the developing embryo, cell differentiation helps groups of cells to undergo certain modifications to form specialized tissues and organs to form into an organism. Now, with this, we complete the two types. But again, always there will be something. What are the advantages of sexual reproduction? You know, there will be flux of exchange of genes. There will be vigor and vitality resulting in variations. Since there are variations, they become the raw materials for evolution. And caring of young ones is very high, especially in case of animals. Now, what are the disadvantages? Again, it is a slow process because the organism has to go through two phases. That is the juvenile phase, which is quite long, and then into the reproductive phase. And it requires a lot of resources. It's commonly biparental. And again, fertilization is a chance factor. Either it is an external fertilization or internal fertilization. A large number of young ones die due to poor genetic makeup in the phase of high levels of competition. Now, as we say, for everything, there is a... So with this, we complete the process of sexual reproduction. And what is the chapter on reproduction itself? So in the next chapter, we shall look in the reproduction in the plants. So with this, we complete all the key points that are required for this lesson. Now, let us look into the test. Look into the test, reproduction in organisms. Okay, the period from birth to death, from birth to the natural death of an organism represents lifespan. No individual is immortal except single-celled organisms. The term used for the offsprings that are exactly identical to one another, as well as identical to their parents, we call them clones. Find the correct combination, buds and hydra. The chromosome number is haploid in the gametes. Fleshy buds produced in the adult, which grow to form new plants when shed and fall to the ground, are called bulbils. The most significant value of producing large population of individuals genetically identical to the parents. Among the following, which one is not a method of asexual reproduction? Sowing is not a method of reproduction. You're sowing the seed, that means which is a product of sexual reproduction. In plants, meiosis occurs in the anther. Syngamy refers to fusion of gametes. Seeds are called products of sexual reproduction because they are formed by fusion of gametes. Bamboo species flower only once in lifetime. There is one flower called Kuntiana scurangi. That is the one which flowers, Rhodilanthus Kuntiana scurangi, which flowers once in 12 years. Estrus cycle occur in the females of the cows, not in the primates. Primates will show menstrual cycle. Reptiles are oviparous because they lay eggs. In animals, juvenile phase is followed by reproductive phase. So here you see all the answers are correct. If the answer is some answer is wrong, then it will be showing in a red color. If you go click it, you will be able to identify your answer and also the correct answer. In this way, it is really going to help you to analyze your mistakes because an explanation is also given. If it is unanswered, it will be showing in yellow color. But it is better if you do not know the answer, correct answer, don't try to just make a wild guess. If you do that, it is going to cost you from your total. You will be losing one mark because it is going in for negative correction. Now with this, we come to an end of this session, that is for this lesson. Now here you see NEET full tests, which are 38 in number, out of which 15 are created by the tutors, taking into account the different kinds of questions that can probably be asked in NEET, and also 20 and odd past papers that have been solved. So all these would really help you to prepare well for your exams. In case if you want to ask anything, you can ask, use the ask feature and mail your, and you can ask. And we also support the student chat and the Telegram group. And also if you want to have one-to-one tutions, you are most welcome to write your queries to info@play6.com and you will be given replies quickly. Thank you. Hope to catch up with you in the next session.